Khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And today is the sixth session of our series and final session, to be honest. And I'm Abdul Rahman, as you know. And today we'll be looking at the last part of this particular lesson. Specifically, we'll be looking at coordination and homeostatic process. Right? So this is the final part of the lesson. So let us go through the content that we have today. First of all, when we speak about coordination and homeostasis in humans, we have to understand some terms. So understanding and defining some of the terms will help us to establish this concept further and make us to have a better concept or a clearer concept about coordination and homeostasis. First of all, when we speak about coordination, what we mean is the adaptations of the body according to the internal and external environment fluctuation. So it simply means that how our body changes or how our body responds according to the changes which happens inside the body, which is the internal environment, and outside the body, which is outside of our body, to be exact. So the adaptations of the body according to the changes, internal and external environment changes, is what we mean by coordination. And this change comes according to a stimulus. Stimulus, and in plural terms we call it as stimuli. It means a detectable change in the environment. So if there is a change in the environment, whether it be internal or external, most of the time the stimulus comes from external environment, we call that as stimulus. So according to the stimulus only, we can have some sort of a response. So to detect this stimulus, we have sensory organs. So sensory organs, or we call them as receptors as well. These are the organs that help us to detect stimulus. So can you name some of the sensory organs that you know of? Sensory organs in the body? Yeah, as you mentioned, ear, then eyes, skin, tongue, these sort of things can be termed under sensory organs, because each of them responds to a particular stimuli, right? And the way that we react to that particular stimulus is known as a response. For example, sometimes when we smell something really nice, we might act out by salivating. So that may be a response. So sometimes when we touch something very hot, so we feel that hotness through the skin, we receive that through the sensory organ, and our reaction will be to take the hand away very fast from that particular place. So that is a response. So sometimes we might hear some sort of a loud noise and we might want to run away from that place. That is the response. So to make that response feasible, we have effectors. So effectors are those things which bring about these responses. So usually effectors can be glands, such as salivary gland, because when we sense something that is very tasty, we start to salivate. So we might have a gland in that case, or it can even be a muscle. For example, suddenly we touch something that is very hot, we remove the hand, so that particular response or the signal has to go through to our muscles in the hand. So these things which bring about these responses are known as effectors. So did you get these five terms properly? Right, good. So then let's move on to an example. So we are explaining the process of drinking water here. So how the process of drinking water happens in terms of coordination. So first of all, we will see the object. A glass of water can be seen by the eye. So the eye is the receptor in this case, the sensory organ, or the eye is the receptor. So what we see will be converted or will be taken, converted into electrical signals and sent through the sensory neuron. And then it will be relayed to the brain, or it can be the central nervous system. So we can say central nervous system or the brain. So through a neuron, another neuron, it will be relayed to the brain. So the brain will decide, or it will instruct through the motor neuron to the effector to pick it up. Okay, you are feeling thirsty, so pick up that particular glass. So this is a typical example of coordination that happens within our body. And as you can see, the nervous system is involved here. Nervous system is just one of the systems that is involved in coordination. For this example, we have considered the nervous system. So the systems which are responsible for coordination can be divided into two mainly. The main one being nervous system, and then we also have an endocrine system. So let us look at one of these systems first, and then we'll look at the other system thereafter. So first of all, we are going to focus on the nervous system. So the coordination that happens through the system of nerves is what we call as nervous coordination. So what happens is, due to the electrochemical changes that happens within these nerves, impulses will be transmitted. It can be electrical impulses most of the time, and these impulses aim at a specific effector. For example, suppose that we touch something that is very hot. Suppose there is an iron box there, and we are keeping our hand on that particular hot part of the iron box, and suddenly the impulse will be transmitted in such a way that we will remove that hand, not the other hand. So the impulse is aimed at a specific effector. So we should have to understand that as well. And we should know that when we speak about the nervous system, the structural unit of the nervous system is known as neuron, not the functional unit, but rather the structural unit. It simply means that our nervous system comprises of millions and millions of neurons. So neurons make up the nervous system, right? So what are the basic types of neuron according to your syllabus? So according to your syllabus, we have three types of neurons. The first one, or one of them, being the motor neuron, and then we have the interneuron and sensory neuron. You can see that all three of them have different structures, right? Can you see the difference in structure? Yes, you can see the difference in structure and myelin sheaths as well. So when it comes for you to study a bit deeper, you can just revise this stuff. And we can see we have the axon here, which is in white color part, is what we call as axons. Then we have dendrites, and we have the cell body as well, right? So to receive the sense, or to receive the stimuli, we use the sensory neuron. Suppose we see something beautiful, that will be transmitted through the sensory neuron, and it will pass the interneuron, or the relay neuron in some case. And whatever the action, for example, let's say that we are seeing, or we look at a beautiful flower, and we, let's say that our intention is to pluck it. So through the eye and through the sensory neuron, that particular impulse will be transmitted to the central nervous system, and we will think through our brain, and using the brain we will think, and we will think, okay, I'm going to pluck it off. So that particular thing will be transmitted through the motor neuron, so that we can use our hands and grasp that particular flower and pluck it. So basically, these are the three types of neurons that we have. We also have unipolar, bipolar. You can see bipolar, unipolar, and those sort of things. But according to our syllabus, this is how we categorize the neuron based on the function, right? And when we look at the nervous system, we can see that in our body, in the human body, there are two types of nervous system. So can you tell me what these two types of nervous system are? Yes, as you said correctly, central nervous system, CNS, and peripheral nervous system. So the central nervous system is what we know most of. It is to do with the brain and spinal cord. And in peripheral nervous system, we have cranial nerves and spinal nerves. So we will look at the function of these two separately. But for the moment, just we have to know that there are 12 pairs of cranial nerves and 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And the brain, we will look later as well, is divided into three main parts known as cerebrum, cerebellum and medulla oblongata. Right? Let's go through to discuss the brain now. So, if you take our central nervous system, it is protected because we have spine and we have the skull. So, what happens is the skull will protect the brain, the main center of central nervous system, and the vertebral column that we have will protect the spinal cord. So, to protect the brain, we have the skull, and to protect the spinal cord, we have vertebral column. So, there is a thin sort of a tissue-like structure that covers the brain and spinal cord. We call that as meninges. So, this is like a layer or meninges that can diffuse stuff in between. So, on top of meninges, we have a fluid. So, this fluid is filled within the skull and we call this as cerebrospinal fluid. So, within this particular liquid only, our brain rests. So, a brain is actually floating within this particular fluid. We can't say it is floating like as we can imagine, but in a very, very minute amount of layer, there is a layer of liquid that is quite important to absorb shocks and provide nutrition, stuff like that. So, this particular fluid is what we call as cerebrospinal fluid. It is within the cavity of the skull and also within the spaces of vertebral column. Now, what are the main functions of cerebrospinal fluid? As we mentioned, first of all, it absorbs the shocks and jerks. So, it is very important to it acts as a shock absorber. Similarly, when we take a vehicle such as a car or a bike or a van, we have some sort of shock absorbers. Similarly, to absorb the shocks that are presented towards the CNS, cerebrospinal fluid is coming. And secondly, it supports the buoyancy or the bouncy of the brain and spinal cord, as they say here. But anyway, one other thing is it also helps us to protect against the temperature fluctuations. Because as you can see, the temperature, if it fluctuates, when we go to homeostasis, we will see that even a minute change in temperature can affect the cellular processes of human beings. So, we should have to have a sort of a backup mechanism where we can manage that as well. And the next one is the protection against microbial infection. So, it is available so that the brain or the CNS, to be exact, can be protected from these infections as well. Now, if you take the brain, there are some interesting facts about the brain. So, what are these interesting facts? The first one being, it is around 1/50th of the body weight. So, if you are 50 kg, that is, if that is your particular mass, if that is 50 kg, maybe your brain is just 1 kg, 1/50th. Within that, we have almost 100 billion neurons. So much of neurons are available within the brain. To support these brains, to do some supportive functions, we have accessory cells. And these cells are known as neuroglia. So, neuroglia are what we call as accessory cells that are present in the brain. And then we also have the peripheral area, that means the outside area, it is gray color. We call it as gray matter. And the interior area, if you cut through the brain horizontally or vertically to take a cross section, you might find that the interior area is white. That is due to myelin sheaths. So, you should remember the brain, the outside area is in gray and the interior area or the area within the brain is white. And the reason that it is white is because of presence of myelin sheaths. And as you can see, we have a large portion. What do you call this large portion? What is the term that we use for this large portion? Cerebrum, or in layman terms, we can say forebrain. And then we have a similar structure at the back, but not as big or convoluted as the front one. We call the cerebellum. And then we also have a brain stem or medulla oblongata. Right. Now, we have to know some of the main concepts of the main facts about cerebrum, because it is needed or required through your syllabus. So, let's go through some of the main concepts or the facts that is presented to you regarding cerebrum. So, cerebrum, as you can see obviously from the previous photograph, you can see it is the largest part of the brain. And then it has two hemispheres. We have the left hemisphere and right hemisphere. One of the interesting facts about brain is the left hemisphere that we have here, the left hemisphere, it will control the right part of the brain, and the right hemisphere will control the left part of the, not the brain actually, of the body. So, just remember, the left hemisphere will control the right part of the body or the right half of the body, and the right hemisphere will control the left half of the body. And we can see that cortex is highly convoluted. It simply means that there are so much of curves within that. It looks like as if it has so much and so much of large amount of surface area. So it's highly convoluted. There are small like structures on top of the brain that make it look like convoluted. And the left hemisphere, as I mentioned, it controls the right half of the body, and the right one controls the left half of the body. These are some of the facts regarding cerebrum, right? Now, at a glance, let us look at the functions of all these three. In your book, it is given separately, but just to make it clear and make it more interesting and easy for us to remember, we have included all of these functions in one slide. So, when we take the cerebrum, the main part, as you can see, there are so much of lines, we call this as convolutions. We can see that it is important, or it is the main part, or these lobes are important for intelligence, learning and judgment. And it is also there to receive the senses, for example, sense of vision, sense of taste, sense of hearing, smell, and the movement of voluntary muscles, especially skeletal muscle movement. So, these three, along with speech and memory, of course, are responsible, or these functions are performed by the cerebrum. But these are not the only functions, but these are the main functions that we know of. Please remember that. If somebody asks you for sure what are the functions of cerebrum, we can't say only these four are the functions. There may be other functions, but these are still being researched and still not being found. And then we have cerebellum. Cerebellum is important for the posture of the body. So, if something happens to the cerebellum, if there's a huge blow to the cerebellum, we might not be able to balance ourselves, and this is the main center for coordination. So, coordination and balance of the body is where the cerebellum comes in, and it is also important to maintaining the posture of the body. And then we have medulla oblongata, or the brain stem that we have here. This particular thing is important for changes in heart rate, one of those things, because the heart rate can be controlled by this particular part of the brain. And then we have breathing, blood pressure, vomiting, swallowing, all of these things are controlled, and digestion. So, similarly, or you can say that almost some of the involuntary actions performed by the muscles are done by the brain stem. So, if you put it that way, it might be accurate as well. So, these are some of the functions of the brain that we know of. Now, if you take the spinal cord, now we looked at brain because the brain was the main center for central nervous system, and then we look at the second part, which is the spinal cord. Now, spinal cord is actually a tubular structure that runs through the vertebral column. So, within the vertebral column, it runs through like a tube. But the difference between, or the main difference between the structure or the concept of brain and spinal cord is, just by looking it, we can see that the outside area is white matter and the interior area is gray matter. So, this is the opposite of the structure in the brain. So, in the brain, we have the peripheral area as gray matter, and the interior area is white matter, but rather in the spinal cord, we can see that it is the other way around. Now, if you can look at this particular picture, can you see this picture? Yes, you can see that the outside area is much darker than the inner area, right? Yes, so from that we can understand that stuff as well, right? Now next we are going to look at what a reflex arc is. So the reflex arc is the functional unit of the nervous system. The functional unit of the nervous system is what we call as the reflex arc. Now can you tell me, as we discussed earlier, what is the structural unit of the nervous system? The structural unit is the neuron, right? Okay. Now as you can see, the reflex arc involves three types of cells or three types of neurons. We have the sensory neuron and the interneuron and as well as the motor neuron in this case. For example, now what has happened here is that we have included a classical example to go through that. Let us go through that example here. We can see there is a particular lamp or a candle here and the person is touching the flame. Accidentally or voluntarily, they are touching the flame. So what happens is the finger, or in this case the skin in the finger, will receive that. That stimulus will be received and it will be transmitted to the spinal cord. So the spinal cord, what happens in the spinal cord, this will be transmitted through the afferent neuron, which we know as sensory neuron in our syllabus. So then what will happen is in the spinal cord, this particular action is already pre-programmed. So through the interneuron, it will be transmitted back to the effector neuron or efferent neuron or motor neuron, and the action will be, suddenly our muscles will jerk and it will take the hand off that particular place. So we call this particular circle or this arc to be exact as the reflex arc. So in reflex arc, can you tell me how many nerves are included here? How many nerves are here? Right, please hold on. Right. Now we'll look at what reflex actions are. We looked at reflex arc. Now let's look at what reflex actions are. So reflex action simply means that it should be sudden and involuntary. We won't think what is happening. That means we don't have time to think, to be honest. So a sudden involuntary response that happens without the involvement of the brain is what we call as reflex action. For example, as we spoke earlier, moving the hand away when it contacts a hot surface is a reflex action. So lifting the leg off of an object that is very sharp, it may be a nail or a thorn, is a reflex action. Similarly, sneezing, we can't control sneezing, or salivation, or blinking. So these things are reflex actions. So based on how they are, we can divide them into two, as spinal reflex action and cranial reflex actions. So spinal reflexes are most of the time like this particular stuff. For example, moving the hand, lifting the leg and stuff like that. And cranial reflex actions are usually like sneezing, blinking and salivation. You don't have to know, or you don't have to define what cranial reflexes or spinal reflexes are in the syllabus. Right. Now let us look at the autonomic nervous system. So auto means, you know that. Well, what do you mean when you say auto? Is that means you don't have a manual control over that, right? So it happens autonomously. That means on its own. So autonomic nervous system, first of all, is involuntary. That means whatever the stuff that is going on cannot be controlled by us. They are involuntary. And the coordinating centers are mainly the medulla oblongata and the hypothalamus. Can you control your heart rate? No, we can't, right? So controlling heart rate is nearly or impossible, to be honest, because it's involuntary. And salivation is something that we can't control. For example, I'm just going through some actions that we can't control. So digestion is something that we can't control. So we should understand medulla oblongata and hypothalamus are the main centers of or coordinating centers when it comes to autonomic nervous system. So there are two types of nervous systems within the autonomic nervous system: the sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic one is where, or what we call as the flight or fight response. For example, just to make it much clearer, sometimes we might see a dog or something and we might want to throw a stone or we might want to run away if it starts barking at us. So it may be a flight or it may be a fight. So that particular response comes from the sympathetic nervous system. And the parasympathetic nervous system, most of the time what it does is it will neutralize the effect that was caused by the sympathetic nervous system. For example, let's say that you see a dog and you just warn, the dog is barking at you and is running towards you, you might want to run away. So you are in flight. You can't run away forever. So after some time, that particular stimulus has to stop. That means you should have to come back to normal. So what happens is, at that time, the parasympathetic nervous system takes control of the body and it will start to relax the actions that we have done so far. So what happens is, parasympathetic nervous system will do the opposite of what sympathetic nervous system does. For example, if the sympathetic nervous system increases the size of the pupil within the eye, the parasympathetic will reduce the size. And for example, if the saliva secretion is inhibited within the glands, it will be stimulated by the parasympathetic. So you can see it is actually the opposite of both. One of them will increase the heart rate, the other one will decrease the heart rate. One of them will increase the heartbeat, the other one will decrease the heartbeat. So peristalsis movement will be decreased by one, it will be increased by the other. So this is what happens within the autonomous nervous system. So I hope that you got a clear idea about the nervous coordination, right? Good. Now let's look at the second system that is involved in coordination, which is the endocrine system. So the coordination that happens via the endocrine system is what we call as chemical coordination. So what happens is, hormones will be secreted to the blood. Now we know that the blood is a connective tissue and it can act as a mode of transport. So it will act on an organ or a muscle or a gland or a duct or whatever the particular space, but that response will be based not on the speed or whatever, but it will be based on the concentration of the hormone. So if the concentration of the hormone is beyond a particular level, a particular effect will take place. If the concentration hormone is lower than the level, that particular effect may not take place. Let's look at an example, then we might be able to understand that as well. Right. So, first of all, as we spoke about hormones, we should have to understand what hormones are, what are the features, what are the characteristics of hormones. One thing that we should understand basically is, hormones are organic compounds. Most of the compounds or most of the stuff that is within our body is organic, and these hormones can be transported through the blood. So blood is one of the main ways in which the hormones act or chemical coordination takes place. So what happens is, the hormones will be produced at one site or one particular area and will act on another area, it will act on another site. So it can stimulate target organs or target cells. So sometimes the hormones may be or should be able to target some organs and sometimes cells, and we don't need to have a large concentration. A very minute concentration of hormone is enough to induce the reaction that we need from this area. So I have given you two pictures about the endocrine system just to make it clear to you. Let us look at the first one. The first one being, this is not actually a male or a female, but rather a compound of both. So we have some glands here, For example, the pineal gland in thalamus and hypothalamus, you can see pituitary gland, then thyroid cartilage of lungs, then parathyroid glands, trachea, adrenal glands, pancreas, uterus, ovaries, thymus. These are some of the glands that are important, or that are the main organs of the endocrine system. So some another photo is given here in a bit of 3D mode, so that to make it much more clearer to you, we can see thalamus, and the adrenal gland is resting on top of the kidney. You can see that as well from this particular photo, right? So let us look at the some of the functions of hormone. So first of all, let us look at the pituitary gland, and we can see that this is located just below the hypothalamus in the cerebrum, and this is what we call as the growth hormone. The growth hormone is where it has to grow the ordinary tissues of the body. So it can grow the bones, it can increase the protein synthesis. So these things will be performed by the pituitary gland, and the hormone is what we call as growth hormone. Thyroid has two types of hormones. One is thyroxine, which we know of, which is important to increase the metabolic rate. And then we have calcitonin, which can reduce the calcium level in the blood. Then we have pancreas. Pancreas is quite important to maintain the blood glucose level. We have insulin and glucagon. Insulin is important to convert glucose to glycogen, and glucagon will do the reverse of that. It will do the opposite of that, and we'll learn about these hormones very soon. Then we have adrenal glands. So adrenaline is a sort of a hormone that gives us a sort of a boost. It will help us to prepare the body during an emergency. For example, let's say that we hear a sudden noise and we want to, and you, or you see a very dangerous wild animal approaching you, or you see a particular car accident, you are going to face a car accident. What will you do next? That godlike speed or godlike decision making skills, that particular alertness is because of this adrenaline hormone. Suddenly you might be, you might be a different person because of this boost. Let's say that you are afraid of spiders, and you might be sitting lazily in the sofa. And if you are afraid of a spider, and let's say that a small spider falls on your lap, what will you do? You will obviously like jump up and start screaming and get up. Get up may be a very mild term. You will actually jump off your feet and start screaming, running around. So this can happen. So that happens, that is because of this. Okay, that is because of adrenaline. Is my voice okay now? Right, okay. Then we have the glands, which is testes and ovaries. These are important, or these are what we call as the sex hormones. Okay, testosterone, estrogen and progesterone. So these are important during sexual reproduction and to develop the secondary sexual characters in humans, right? Now we have come to the last part, which is homeostasis. Homeostasis, as we already spoke in a previous chapter, it means maintaining a constant internal environment. So if you are able to maintain a constant internal environment within the body, we call that we are in a state of homeostasis. So what we mean by internal environment is the tissue fluid which is around the cells, or the plasma in the blood or lymph. If we can maintain these fluids, it can be cerebrospinal fluid, or it can be plasma or lymph. So whatever the environment within this, if that can be balanced and maintained at a constant level, we call that as homeostasis. We should remember that a very minute change in this internal environment can affect the cellular activities. Whatever the activities that happens within the cell can be affected because of a small change. It can be a small change in temperature, a small change in pressure, a small change in supply of oxygen. So a small change in whatever the internal environment will affect the cellular activities. To make it much more clearer, let us look at two examples. The first one is regulation of blood glucose level. So how the blood glucose level is regulated within our body? When the blood glucose level increases beyond a certain limit, the beta cells in islets of Langerhans, which is in pancreas, will secrete insulin. Insulin hormone, what it will do is, it will convert glucose to glycogen, as we saw earlier. So insulin is secreted from beta cells of islets of Langerhans in pancreas. So pancreas is the gland in which, or the organ that secretes insulin, and this glycogen will be stored in liver. Now suppose that we have excess glucose and it cannot be used, this glucose will be converted to fat and it will be stored in adipose tissue. So finally, when the blood glucose level drops down beyond the limit, what happens is, or it comes back to normal, secretion of insulin will halt. That means no more insulin will be secreted and our blood glucose level is regulated. Sometimes what happens is our blood glucose level will decrease or go beyond a point. So at that time what will happen is the alpha cells in islets of Langerhans will secrete glucogen. Earlier it was beta cells that secreted insulin. Now the alpha cells will secrete glucogen. So glucagon, what it can do is it can convert glycogen back to glucose. So when this conversion happens, there may be enough amount of glucose in the blood. So therefore, the blood glucose will be regulated. The healthy body glucose level of a human being is between 80 to 120 milligram per 100 milliliters of blood. So that may be a question in your MCQ or multiple choice question. To regulate the body temperature, what happens is we should know that humans are homeothermic. Homeothermic simply means that whatever the external temperature it might be, the internal temperature will be maintained in a very constant and a small range. That means, for example, the normal body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. It can fluctuate plus or minus 0.5. It can be 36, 36.5, 37, 37.5. It can vary within this range. But if it goes beyond any of these ranges, that means we have a problem in body temperature. So what happens is when the temperature goes up or below this particular range, the hypothalamus that we spoke of earlier, which is found within the cerebrum of the brain, it will act as the thermoregulatory center. So how is this done? So when the temperature of the body increases, the hypothalamus will come into place. It will become the boss. So what hypothalamus will do is it will send some signals. So what are these things? Now, first of all, if the body temperature is high, it has to reduce it. So the blood supply to the skin will reduce. So how it will happen is it will tell or it will instruct the blood capillaries in the skin to contract. So there might be less amount of heat loss. And it will also reduce the amount of sweat that is produced to reduce the heat loss. The hairs will become erect, that means very straight, so that a trap of air layer will be acting as an insulating layer. If there is a very high level of heat loss, we will start to shiver. So this reaction can be seen especially when we are ill or when we are sick. This particular thing might be happening to us. And the second thing is regulation of body temperature when the body temperature drops. So when the body temperature drops, it has to increase the body temperature. That means it has to just send it off. So we can increase the sweat production, we can dilate the blood vessels in the skin, so thereby more heat can be lost from our body. So this is actually what we have it here in temperature balance. To balance the water, what happens is the pituitary gland that we spoke of, this will release ADH or antidiuresis hormone. So this ADH will act on kidney and kidney will increase the reabsorption of water. That is when the water level in the blood drops. When the water level in the blood is higher, the kidney will start to reduce the reabsorption of water. So we can see most of the chemical coordination is important to maintain the homeostasis. So to regulate the water balance, we need ADH. To regulate the sugar level within the blood or glucose level within the blood, we need two glands or two hormones, which is insulin and glucagon. Anyway, this is the end of the session, I think. So do you have any questions regarding this session? Okay then, so let's end this session now.